Okay, welcome everybody. Thanks for coming. Before I introduce our speaker, just a reminder that next week is Charlie Vorismardi from City University of New York, studies global hydrology. He'll be here for the Wednesday. If you have interest in meeting with Charlie, do send me an email and I can try and get you on his agenda. As always, I want to thank Howard Weider, who's come out of his sick bed to join us today. Howard, I hope you're feeling better. And the Canada Excellence Research Chair for underwriting the series and this visit in particular. And it's really a terrific thrill, not just for me, but the campus, to have Clement Tochner with us today. Clement is director of the Leibniz Institute for Freshwater Ecology and Inland Fisheries in Berlin. He also holds a number of other concurrent positions where he's professor for aquatic hydrology at the Free University in Berlin. He's an adjunct scientist at EOAG, one of the ETH institutes, I guess, in Zurich, where he was a faculty member starting in 2007. He's been a guest scientist at the Carey Institute for Ecosystem Studies, has been a JSPS fellow in Japan, and other activities, including international stints in Africa. And I think the students in this morning's class found his experiences in Rwanda and Uganda really interesting. So Clement has been really an international thought leader in ecosystem sciences. He's had some quite important papers. A recent one, Why We Should Care About Temporary Waterways. We were hearing this morning, Al Jazeera, CNN, other new news organizations picking up on that. You'll hear probably a bit about that today. His 2010 paper on light pollution as a biodiversity threat, and a paper, I think, in 2012 in Science on temporary waterways and the fact that about half the world's rivers run dry each year, or lengths of these rivers. So Clement, I think, brings really an interesting perspective on problems and really sees problems in a different light. And I think, you know, seeing what everyone else has seen and thinking what no one else has thought has been kind of a specialty of Clement. For this, he's been recognized as a member of the Academy of Sciences in Austria. This year, he was made an Academy of Science member in Germany, and a number of other awards and prizes and lectures. So it's a real thrill to have Clement with us, and we're looking forward to your talk.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Jeff, for this introduction, and thank you for the invitation. It's a great pleasure, and it's an honor to be here today. Before I start, I just want to acknowledge two people on behalf of many others with whom I collaborated in the last couple of years. One is Christiane Zafel. She was at IGP, and now she is a professor at the University of Tübingen, and Emily Bernhardt, she's at Duke University, and she was a year as a sabbatical fellow at IGP, and a lot of the ideas that I'm presenting today come with the discussion with Christiane and with Emily. Let's start with a satellite image of Europe. If you look on Europe during the day from satellite, you don't see a lot of human influences from this distance. You see some major dams here along the Volga, but otherwise it looks like the whole continent is covered by a kind of green biofilm. This is a satellite image of Europe during the night, about 150 years ago. And this is a satellite image today during the night. And I think this is something you all know, these pictures, and it is showing how we modified our systems. And it's also showing that we illuminated the whole world during the last 150 years. There are three areas where you see, in particular, a huge influence. The first one is the coastal areas. The second one is always the boundaries or the edges of mountain areas. For example, here in the Alps, in a 40-kilometer wide strip along the Alps, there are living more than 20 million of people compared to 12 million in the whole arc of the Alps. And then it's along river valleys. So these are the three areas where we see the highest influence. But this kind of illumination of the world is probably one of the biggest kind of changes of our landscape. It's a completely new stressor that hadn't been here before, and it's a global dimension, and I think we are not aware about how much we are influencing just our systems by illuminating the world. There's an increase at the moment by about 6% in illumination. the rebound effects, because it's becoming always cheaper to illuminate, so more areas are getting illuminated. It's a huge consumption of electricity and producer of greenhouse gas emissions. And we have very little and almost no kind of ideas. What are the ecological, what are the social, what are the human health effects of artificial light? So this is a kind of huge infrastructure, this kind of illumination of the world. We can say this is a global kind of self-experiment with unpredictable outcomes in respect to physiological aspects, socioeconomic aspects, ecological aspects. Novel stressors hadn't been here 150 years ago and now are changing or shaping the whole Earth. I'm giving just one example on this. It may impact evolutionary processes. Nocturnality is a very recent kind of evolutionary effect. So about 50% of all mammals are nocturnal. And so now we are influencing this kind of shaping this. But we also see that there's probably a very rapid adaptation to these new stressors as well, like light pollution. We are doing experimental work here. I'm not showing any results there. We are doing experimental work because one of the the challenges is to separate light pollution from other kind of stressors. So we are illuminating here one of the darkest areas in a nature conservation area in Berlin. We are building these artificial lights here. And we are primarily, as our institute, interested in these aquatic terrestrial linkages and how illumination influences this kind of connectivity. But there are other groups working on birds and bats and other consequences of light pollution there. I'm coming back again, and I said that one of the huge kind of influences where you see this is along river valley. And this is, for example, the Rhine River, which is one of these very illuminated, densely populated areas. So we have a second kind of consequence. We have very difficulties to see how natural systems, at least in Europe, looked originally. There are no photos of the systems, how they were originally. So we have to rely on paintings. So this is here the Alpine Rhine in Switzerland, about 200 years ago, how it looked like, and this is how it looks today. Completely modified system. We have, in particular in Europe, hundreds, thousands of years of modification of these systems here. And we also see that a lot of people now are living or occupying former floodplain systems. This is a kind of new map of floodplains at a global scale here. These are the European floodplains, inundation maps. We have the historic extent and the present extent of floodplains. And this is just a very simple calculation of how many people are living on floodplains and how much kind of wealth is produced in respect to GDP on these floodplain systems. Don't go into the numbers here. These are 28 river basins in Europe. The floodplains covers about 500,000 square kilometers. 60 million people are living there, and about 1.3 trillion of US dollar are produced per year on these floodplain systems. We know it from Japan, for example. In Japan, 50% of the present population lives on floodplains. And about 70% of all assets are produced in these floodplains. So we have this long history of modification. We have this kind of linkage between ecosystem and social systems, and floodplains are, in particular, excellent examples of social ecological systems. So here, this is again the Rhine. There are 9 million people are living there, and a huge amount of GDP is produced on these floodplains. The second one here would be the Seine in France. So Rhine River, as an example, as we see it today, this is a real social ecological coupled system here. And I think it's even more what we did with our systems is what we may call the domestication of ecosystems. It's a very similar process that we can observe for animals and plants. And domestication means that we are forming ecosystems to optimize them for very few services for human benefit, for short-term, partly economic benefit, with unforeseen changes to other ecosystem attributes. So it's a kind of domestication of our globe. And if we are have a goal to develop sustainable floodplains. Because these are kind of domesticated social ecological systems, we have to look on both ecosystem health and human wealth, and then we need indicators for both how to assess ecosystem health and human wealth. Different ecosystem services, but also simple geomorphic, ecological, hydrological indicators. So, taking again these floodplains, floodplains cover about 2% of the continent, of the continental surface globally, but they provide about 25% of all ecosystem services. So, floodplains are strategic ecosystems for both humans and nature alike. Coming back to the Rhine was not just heavily modified morphologically 200 years ago, it was also heavily polluted. 50, 60 years ago, it was the sewer of Europe. There was a big accident in Basel where they released due to the burning of a pharmaceutical company, huge release of pesticides that completely destroyed the Rhine River. So after this accident, they invested about 80 million euro to clean up the Rhine. So this was there was big protests and to clean up the Rhine. This was the sewer of Europe. 60 million people are living in the whole catchment area. Was it a success? So this is the first question. We can see, if we are looking on ammonia, nitrate, oxygen, phosphate, this we see the high levels of phosphate here in the 70s, and then now a decrease. Less nitrate because a lot is coming from T-fuse agricultural pollution. The same is with oxygen, low oxygen levels here, high again, and ammonia almost disappeared today. So we cleaned it up more or less, the Rhine River. Do we see any effect on the kind of ecology as well? This would be the long-term development of benthic invertebrates. We have good data 100 years ago, so we have a kind of information before the pollution happened. And this is a graph that most politicians like and show and say, this is very nice. We cleaned up the river, biodiversity is coming back. So this is the number of species of benthic invertebrates about 120 years ago. Then you have this sharp decline, and then you have again this sharp increase. But there are two aspects that we have to consider. The first one is the communities that we have today have almost nothing in common with the communities 100 years ago. If you take today a sample, a benthic invertebrate sample from the Rhine River or from the Danube, 80 to 90% of all invertebrates are of non-native origin. So you have communities here that have no joint evolutionary history. So it's a kind of multicultural communities that we have there. And the second aspect that we have to consider, 100 years ago, the Rhine River was already completely channelized. So this is not the reference that we consider. So this is, has been already a heavily modified system there as well. So the question is it a success? It is a completely different system than 100 years ago in respect, for example, the biological communities. So what we have is, and we see this all over Europe, you have a kind of change of the communities, which leads to a kind of homogenization of our biotic components. This would be the fish fauna in Europe, and this is just the number of non-native fish species in different catchments. We have comparison 1845 and now. In all catchments, we have a higher diversity or richness today than we had originally. So there's an increase in diversity, but it's primarily due to this non-native species there. And on the same time, you have a homogenization across Europe. Catchments are becoming more and more similar. These areas where you have here red arrows, there are more than 40% of the contemporary fish species richness are all non-native species. A lot of them are located here in the Mediterranean areas. And this is primarily due to the construction of hydropower plant where they stocked them then with non-native species. But you find them across whole Europe. And there's a second factor, and this is again, it's a long history of kind of connecting river systems across Europe. So we have 28,000 kilometers of navigation canals and navigable rivers that create biologically a kind of pan-European catchment. You can travel from southern France to western Siberia today without going to the sea anymore. So we have longitudinally, we are fragmenting the rivers with dams, but horizontally, we are connecting them, making them kind more similar. So what we have is, we have novel, what we call ecological novelty, novel stressors, domesticated novel ecosystems, novel communities. And so there are key questions from a research. How do these new communities form? What are the ecological, evolutionary, economic consequences of domesticated ecosystem novel communities? And what does it mean for conservation and for restoration? In Europe, we have the European Water Framework Directive, where one of the goals is to achieve a kind of good ecological status. But good ecological status is defined on a reference condition, on biotic communities that originally had been there. But there's no way that in these rivers that we will get communities back that had been 20, 100 years ago. So that it's a target that you never will be able to achieve. So we have to change in some way the goal setting for the European Water Framework Directive. If you are talking on ecological novelty, it's not just non-native or invasive species, genetically modified species, and I think synthetic species will be one of the big challenges in the next couple of decades, and then you have emerging pathogens. And we have to understand how they get produced, how they are released in the environment, how they establish, how they spread, and what are their impacts on both humans and biodiversity. And this is happening all here within this kind of envelope of environmental change as well. I think we are not aware, or we have a very little understanding, what kind of biota we will have in 20, 30 years in our systems here. So everyone knows this. So we have this kind of human influence that is shaping the atmosphere, the hydrosphere, the geosphere, and the biosphere. Partly globally, you can't partly not reverse anymore this, and this is what is called the Anthropocene. And it's showing also that humans are a kind of ecological outlier. Just two examples. This would be on CO2 production. This would be 63 species of mammals. Here is humans, and this is the production of CO2, so orders of magnitude higher than any other kind of mammals. And this would be the range size, 500 species of mammals. None of the mammal species has this kind of occupy on the whole globe. So in this way, humans might be considered as ecological or environmental outliers. Again, we have this kind of big acceleration. So we have this kind of sharp increase, whatever we are looking for, if we are looking on dam construction, water use, the number of McDonald's restaurants you everywhere see since the Second World War, this kind of rapid increase. Let's take an example, and this would be damming of rivers. We had this very sharp increase in the 70s, 80s, and then now it was flattening up. And what we see at the moment as well, and I'm coming back just in a minute, is we see now an immense increase or boom in hydropower dam construction. But before I go there, I want to mention two aspects. The first one is we have to be aware that freshwaters are one of the most fascinating and diverse ecosystems on Earth, comparable to tropical rainforests or to coral reefs. They cover less than 1% of the globe. They contain 10% of all animals, 1/3 of all of all vertebrates, and 40% of all fish species. At the same time, freshwaters are more threatened than any other ecosystem types. And this is just looking on European vertebrates that got globally extinct since 1700. There's one marine, two terrestrial, and all other are freshwater species. Primarily, a lot of them are fish species that just evolved after the last glaciation and now went extinct already. So we have a very high pressure on the freshwater ecosystems in respect to decline of biodiversity. The second aspect that I would like to mention here is we have this Intergovernmental Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services. So there's a very close link between biodiversity and ecosystem services, and I would call it we have a problem, in particular a challenge in respect to this ecosystem service concept. You find recently more and more papers, also in the scientific literature, where hydropower dam production or navigation are considered as ecosystem services. But hydropower production is not an ecosystem service. You need volume and slope. Navigation is not an ecosystem service. It's better you have a concrete canal. A functioning ecosystem may even be something constraining navigation as well. This is a geosystem service, but not an ecosystem service. So we have a kind of dilemma in respect to this ecosystem service concept. It's a very fascinating concept, but it's a very high degree of misuse in some way. And there is also this kind of close link between biodiversity and ecosystem services, implying that there is a very close link, but very often you don't find the close link. So there is, and this is my personal opinion, there's a huge danger that in respect to management, everything is related to ecosystem services, and we forget a little bit about biodiversity. But I think the decline of biodiversity is probably the biggest challenge we are facing as humans. First, you can't reverse it, and the second is we have no idea what are the consequences of 10, 20, 50% of decrease of biodiversity. So I think we have to be very careful in applying the ecosystem service concept, that it is not kind of misused as it is with hydropower dam or hydropower production or navigation. So I will talk now about hydropower dam construction. Why to talk about hydropower dam? First, we have increase in global population, increase in global economy. There is a need to close the electricity gap. 1.4 billion people have no access to electricity. So this increases the demand for electricity. It increases the demand for energy sources. Then you have climate change. And it increases the demand on renewable energy. Hydropower has a lot of benefits. It's a well-established technique. For 100 and more years, it had been in place. There are multiple, a lot of advantages with hydropower, but there are, of course, also some disadvantages. So we were not looking on the present hydropower dams. We were looking on which dams are are planned or are under construction globally. So we were looking for more than 350 sources to get the information, and the most important was the exact coordinates and the dimension of the future hydropower dams. And then we geo-referenced a lot of them, and based on this, we can see that we are facing a global boom in hydropower dam construction in the next 2 decades. So this is the past increase, and this is always the increase, the new dams within the dam, and this is what we have more or less a doubling that we may expect in the near future. These are the present hydropower dams that are in operation, major hydropower dams. This is just hydropower dams. There are a lot of other dams that are not used for hydropower production, for irrigation, drinking water, flood control. And this is the dams, this close to 4,000 dams now that are planned or under construction. Blue are under construction and red are planned. And you see it's more or less filling up the gaps. We see the major kind of boom in South America, Balkan, Anatolia, the Himalaya area, Southeast Asia, and large parts of Africa. So just again, to the extent of future hydropower dam production, so there will be almost a doubling in the next 20 years. Small and medium-sized dams will dominate in number, but they do not provide a lot to the total electricity capacity, and it will be in particular large dams that will produce most of the future hydropower capacity. So again, here there are some catchments where we see the potential increase in hydropower capacity. Catchments in Africa, Southeast Asia, Amazonia. So these are areas that are where we will see the huge kind of change in hydropower production in the next 20 years. Take an example of South America. This is the share in technically feasible hydropower potential. This is the present one, and this is the future one. So in many countries, there are a manifold increase in the exploitation of the technically feasible hydropower plant hydropower potential. The green numbers mean the feasible hydropower per year and per capita, because in some areas, like in Peru or in Chile, you have a very high potential of hydropower per person and year. Hydropower development is a very global business as well. We see that the average, the investment in hydropower has increased more than sixfold within the past decade. And if all these 4,000 hydropower dams will be constructed, just the construction costs will be about $2 trillion. And it's not as originally were the World Bank and so on were the investors. Now it's primarily private investors. Hydromine and Sinohydro, for example, are the main investors in Africa here. There's no correlation between the economic power of a country and the investment in future hydropower dam construction. Because of this company as well, probably the energy that is produced for primarily for mining or for industry as well. So there are side effects that may be considered in this way as well. So what are the consequences of hydropower dam construction in relation to the electricity gap? Take three examples. In India, there are almost 300 million people that are lacking electricity, but there's a very low technically feasible hydropower potential in the area where you have no electricity. Brazil, again, quite a large population lacking electricity, but the feasible electricity is probably not used for closing the electricity gap, but for export and mining. In Kenya and Tanzania, it's the same. Already enough hydropower installed to close the gap, but again, it's primarily used for economic development and not for closing the electricity gap. What are the consequences for climate change? Again, one of the key reasons for hydropower dam construction. So there is from 20 to 40% an increase of the exploitation of the technically feasible hydropower potential within the next decades. The share of hydropower on renewable energy will not increase at all, almost, because the energy increase is so high that it's just kind of the same increase in the relative proportion of renewable energy. So it will not be able to substitute non-renewable resources. And this is maybe one area where we don't have a lot of information, is that hydropower reservoirs, in particular in the tropics, will be also major emitters of greenhouse gas emissions. When you talk to, let's say, International Hydropower Association, they really emphasize that there are not enough data to really state how important hydropower dams are as greenhouse gas emitters in the near, in particular this one who will be constructed in these tropical and subtropical regions. How will it influence ecological processes, like the fragmentation? Quite a lot of the new major dams, they will be constructed in the remaining free-flowing rivers, large river systems. And there is a second kind of transformation. It's the moderately or low-impacted system that they will be heavily fragmented in the near future. We did this, again, together with colleagues here in Canada, to look on the degree of fragmentation of dams in the last 80 years. So about 80 years ago, you had 75% who were completely unaffected by regulation. Now, you have only about 8% or so who are free-flowing, and this would be the future. The future will be that these systems that are at the moment very moderately will be very strongly influenced, and so about 90% of all rivers are strongly influenced by dam construction, which has influences not just on the migration of species, it had influences on the flow regulation, particularly the sediment regimes of whole river catchment systems. And the future dams, they will be constructed in biodiversity hotspots. This is the species richness of the freshwater megafauna, fish, reptiles, mammals. And it's exactly the areas where we will have the future boom in hydropower dam construction are these areas with the highest freshwater biodiversity. These are surrogates in some way for the entire freshwater biodiversity. There is another aspect that I'm not considering here is that, of course, the decision-making processes in these areas, kind of civil society, is not in the same way established like in Europe or in North America in respect how to build the dams, where to build them, and how to operate them. The question is not hydropower dams, yes or no, but the question is this: where to build them, how to build them, and how to operate them. So these are some very simple questions that we have to answer. The dimension of the upstream-downstream impacts, cumulative effects of dams. What are kind of delay effects? What are additional effects like the sediment regime effects on deltic areas and coastal areas? How can we develop an integrated assessment of the ecological, of the economic and the social consequences of dams and to provide a kind of sustainable hydropower dam construction and operation? So the other question is, we have this big acceleration. Are we at the end of this big acceleration? So should it level off? I don't think so. I think we are just at the beginning of the big acceleration. So I think we are not probably able to imagine what we will see in the next decades. Hydropower dams was one example. So what we see and what we may expect is what we may call terraforming. So we are completely remodeling the Earth's surface. We have this here, of course, when you have these mining areas, we have them in Germany as well, where huge areas are completely remodeled on the surface. I just start with three examples that everyone knows about. This is the Nicaragua Canal that they just started to construct this year here, parallel to the Panama Canal, and it will influence one of the most fascinating freshwater systems, some of the most fascinating terrestrial ecosystems. This is in China, where they level off whole areas to create space for cities. So this is an area where there's 700 mountains are being leveled off to create 250 square kilometers of flat lands to construct their cities. And this is just the Linking River project here in India, where the new prime minister decided to start with these 15,000 kilometers of canals. They are navigable canals here to link the Himalayan and many rivers here in the Indian Peninsula. So we were looking on large infrastructure projects, not just on dams, but on other infrastructure projects that are somewhere in plant, that are somewhere on the desk or beneath the desk, and that are in the face. So these are dams, transfer project, restoration project, and so on. Many of them probably you know. Here you have the dams. Here they are projected costs. You have this national river linking here in India. You have the Sibiral project in Russia, in China, in Arabic Peninsula, South Korea, and so on. You just compare this with the GDP of Greece. So you see these are projects. And these are always the lowest estimated costs, several times higher than the estimated one. So you may imagine these big projects, if an economy like in Greece may really shape the economy of the globe, these big projects have the potential to really have global implication, also in economic dimensions. And this is the global investment in the water sector for urban and water infrastructure. It's about $500 billion US dollar per year. But this is primarily investment in Europe, in the developing countries for drinking water and sanitation. I give here an example for another infrastructure that is of global importance, and these are biological field stations. So we just finished now a kind of inventory of all biological field stations that are there. There are 1,300 biological, limnological, terrestrial, and marine field stations. They're distributed across the globe here, and the budget is about $1 billion per year. And this biological field station is a huge infrastructure that may have a huge potential for global monitoring programs, for biodiversity assessments, supporting IPBES, IPCC, and other GeoBond, and so on. Let's take two or three examples. This is the Lake Aral. Everyone knows about this. It's somehow it's completely given up. No one is willing to invest anything in saving the Lake Aral. There are about 25 endemic species. More or less, most of them are gone. But there had been this fascinating project, in some way fascinated project, the Sipiral project, to transfer water here from Siberia down to the system. It's about 2,000 kilometers, and it's about the Danube, the volume of the Danube that is transferred here to Central Asia. This had been stopped 1986 by Gorbachev. But now, just in the recent years, they start to unearth all the kind of archives in the former institutes, like in the Academy of Russia, to get this information again together, because political will has changed both in Russia and in Central Asia as well. So it's a kind of revival of this project. Peter Glick names this zombie project, because somehow they are dead, but they are not dead again. So they are undead projects. And I think all these projects that are somewhere planned, they're looking for a kind of windows of opportunity to get again maybe on the table and discussed. You are probably more aware about this North American Great Water Project, the Navapa Project, for example, from the Alaska system. And this is dimensions where several hundred square kilometers, cubic kilometers, should be transported down to southwestern US and to Mexico. Looks like kind of unbelievable project, but probably, I'm very sure that this kind of projects will again will come to the surface in the discussion when there is a window of opportunity. And the calculations are here in the thousands of billions, what it would cost here to construct such a project. So what we see is a kind of pandemic array of transformations in the water cycle. And we have all these mega projects. So these mega projects, they are built on self-confidence about technological progress. And they are considered to stimulate economic growth, but it's also a kind of sign of power. The second is that there was a kind of assessment of past hydropower projects, the costs. There's a systematic underestimation of the costs. It's about 100% more expensive than they had been planned. And this is what is called the survival of the unfittest. Mostly the worst projects get funded because there's an underestimation of risk and an overestimation of benefits. Otherwise, this project would not get support. The third one is that this mega project, they also constrain very much the development of other options for decades, for centuries as well. And we see it in many places, like the Aral Lake is a very good example. The drying up of the Aral Lake is the kind of the change of the hydrological cycle in the upstream area, hydropower dam, irrigation, and so on. And these problems are again tried to be solved by engineering solutions. So engineering solutions are used for solving some of the damages that partly are caused by engineering solutions. There's what is required is a kind of reference-based forecasting. You need in this decision an outside view. And you also need a kind of benchmarking against similar projects. This, again, already will reduce very much the risk of such projects. And then there's the question, and I'm curious, is ecological engineering? And ecological engineering means that you simulate in some way ecological processes. It's like bionic, where you simulate this. Is this a way how we can go ahead? It would, at least it would mean that the linkage between ecology or environmental science and engineering science is probably extremely important in respect to planning and of all these large projects here. This was just one example there, the change of the kind of hydro systems. This is another example. It's just a global road network. Until 2050, 25 million new kilometers of roads will be constructed. Of course, this has also consequences on all the river and all the freshwater systems. So if you overlay this, then I'm very sure what we will see in the next decades is an even an acceleration of this kind of transformation of our Earth's surface. And this terraforming, I think it's becoming really reality. So, last week, Claudia Ball-Wostel was here, so she has this kind of triple learning loops here, that this is just based on flood control, that you have a kind of single loop, this would be just improving conditions, building higher dikes or so. Second would be reframing. For example, to look, how can we create resilient landscapes and so on? But the third one be is kind of a completely transforming. Do we need completely new regulations? Do we need completely new actors and management practices? Probably we need a kind of transformation in the whole decision-making as well. And the point, the question that I have to myself always, what is the contribution that science can have? What can we contribute to provide the kind of evidence and options of different kind of strategies that are in place, like all these kind of major mega projects that are somewhere under the desk? I would like to finish with three slides. I told you about biological diversity, probably the decrease or the change of biological diversity, one of the biggest challenges humans are facing. If we are talking about biological diversity, we are talking a diversity of ecosystems, species, and genes. And I think what we have here in this biological diversity, this is the libraries of the nature. There's the information of more than 2 billion years of evolution is stored in this biodiversity. This is like the libraries we have. So the ecosystem would be the libraries, the species would be the books, and the gene variations would be the books to a specific topic. And I think everyone would agree that we would not allow that we treat our cultural kind of libraries or heritage in a similar way how we are treating our ecosystem libraries, our libraries of the nature. We are burning down natural libraries. I had the opportunity to work in one of these fascinating libraries over the last 15 years. This is the Tagliamento River in northeast Italy, so it's the last more or less near natural river system in Central Europe. A fascinating place to work there. Just to give you a few numbers, the catchment area is 2,300 square kilometers, but the maximum discharge is 4,000 cubic meter. So you may imagine this kind of flashy system that you have there. And after 15 years of work there, what did we learn? That we can make a really recommendation to managers. What is the key outcome? What is the simple outcome that we can ensure? And I think the most, I would say one of the most important outcomes is, which is relevant for managers well, one of the key elements along natural system is just dead wood. So this large dead wood, this is probably one of the biggest forces that influences hydrological, geomorphic, ecological processes there. This is in the Alluvial Sound National. This is not from the Tagliamento, from the Alluvial Sound National Park. After the designation of a national park, it was not allowed anymore to remove large wood. And just not to remove this large wood created within a few years this very fascinating landscape here. So this is a very simple recommendation. No maintenance work to some areas, keep the large wood there, and it would be really help a kind of self-regeneration of many of these ecosystem processes there. And with this, I would like to thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks, Clement, for a fascinating talk. Time for some questions. Looking at the class members, Shelby, Kelsey, others that may not have had a chance. Yes, great. Grab the microphone if you can, because, yeah.
Okay, so I kind of get from what your talk that all of these dams building in the future, it's not good for our ecosystems. So not all of these are in construction yet. So is there something in place that maybe yourself you'd like to see, or governments, that kind of thing, to go to these private companies and say, hey, look, you building this dam in 20 years might like completely change this ecosystem. Is there anything that you'd like to see, like as in what you would do to kind of sway their decisions on where they put these dams?
Thank you very much for this question. The International Hydropower Association, they have the sustainability protocols. So there are protocols in place. They have to be improved because and some aspects had to be added. So they are existing. But the question is of the first is of the implementation. And the second one is, this is always an assessment of individual dams, but you have cumulative effect. What happens when there are 6 dams, 10 dams, 20 dams in the catchment area? So the assessment is very often on individual dams then. The second point is, we need a kind of systematic conservation or management plan for large areas as well, that we have a kind of prioritization where we should build these dams. The third thing is, we need information. Our study on these large dams, this database, this was €20,000. So this was a very cheap project in some way. Some basic information, like the location of the future dam, was not available. So if you have a program where 2,000 or 2 trillion will be invested, and we don't have the basic information, and we are not considering this, there's something probably also on us that we provide this information as well. So having this database, we got a lot of requests now for collaboration as well, because we can link it now with sediment dynamics, phosphorus, socio-economic consequences as well. So it provides quite a lot of helpful information for the future. So we have these protocols in place. It's a question of implementation. It's a question of systematic planning as well on a larger scale. And it's coming back. What can we as scientists, which role can we play in this whole issue as well?
Thanks. Other questions? Yeah. Crystal.
Thank you. Hi, Clement. I really liked your analogy of the libraries, but with the global population predicted to increase by another 4 billion people, and we're losing species every single day, your message in that we can't put a price on ecosystem services, I agree, but what else can we do as a scientist to try and put a value to biodiversity in order to conserve it for the future?
Well, thank you for the question. I think this value, it's not just economic value. We have to consider the whole range of values to put in. One value would be an ethical value. So how do we integrate ethical issues in this kind of decision making as well? I think it's not a question. I'm sometimes, when people say we are too many people on Earth, this is a very unethical issue. But what does it mean? We should get rid of some people? Of whom should we get rid? So this is something we have to live with. So this kind of increase is happening. So how to integrate the different kind of components of this ecosystem services, including biodiversity. Biodiversity can be a driver of an ecosystem service, but can be per se an ecosystem service as well. The beauty of biodiversity is an ecosystem. The aesthetic value is an ecosystem service as well. So I think the point is that this kind of domestication where we maximize for very few ecosystem services, that this is something we have to avoid. And we have to find synergies, how to balance among these different ecosystem services as well. And with this, we see, this is in Germany as well, we see this kind of boom in bioenergy, so biofuel production. This is a maximization for one service, for example. But it has incredible consequences for other properties and functions of ecosystems. And I think we are not considering them enough in respect. So biofuel had been implemented, or the kind of goal setting, let's say 40% of the energy in Germany has to be renewable within the next 15 to 20 years. It's a political setting. There was no science immediately. We are looking now, what are the scientific consequences of this? Why we are not involved in goal setting somehow as well. So I think this ecosystem service concept has a big advantage if it is used in a balanced way to really consider the different services and not just the economic benefit. Mm-hmm.
Good. Other comments, questions? Yeah.
You had a very interesting slide where you were talking about the Rhine and the change of composition of the ecosystems. Could you maybe expand on that a little more? And you said it's a slide that the politicians like because you've recaptured the range of biodiversity, but it's different. So what's the lesson from that in terms of future conservation?
The first lesson is what I said is we cannot have targets in the past for the future in respect to composition, for example, or composition of biodiversity, but we could use functions, ecosystem processes. Because the ecosystem processes, also this novel communities, may provide the same functions than the original one as well. So this is one lesson. The second lesson, I think we have to be, because this kind of formation of novel ecosystems, there are different processes. There's a kind of background change. There's a kind of change due to climate change. So there's a range expansion. And then, of course, you have the introduction of new species, exotic species, some of them invasive species. We have to be careful in respect because non-native species are considered as something bad, but there's no scientific underpinning for this. We see it in the Hudson River, for example, when you had the introduction of the Dracaena, how it changed the system. And if you look on the consequences, after 5, 10, 15 years, you would make different kind of recommendations how to manage it. So time is an aspect as well. The third lesson is, this is a European issue. We have the Water Framework Directive, and there are kind of two aspects, the non-deterioration principle and the restoration principle, so to improve the condition. And I think the non-deterioration principle must have a much higher kind of value than the restoration principle. But this is, again, not the case. We are not able to conserve some of these remaining near-natural systems, but we are investing much more in restoring heavily degraded systems. The Tagliamento River I showed before, this fascinating, nice river, it's always under threat. They want to build dams, they want to build a highway across. It's not protected. It's in this Natura 2000 network. This is this conservation network. It's excluded partly because there might be because they want to use it gravel exploitation. So we are not able to maintain some of the very valuable systems as well. So this non-deterioration principle, this has to be a higher kind of priority than the restoration principle. So these are just three of these lessons.
Good. Thanks. Yes.
In your work, you mentioned that there are a lot of transboundary conflicts for water resources as well as conflicts between upstream and downstream communities. So in your experience, like, is there an example of a conflict that was resolved that you were a part of or that you've studied in great detail?
We didn't study any of these kind of transboundary conflicts. I visited... Last May, I visited Uzbekistan, and there you have this huge kind of conflict between the upstream countries where they produce hydropower and the downstream areas where they need it for irrigation. But there's this mismatch. The hydropower is in winter produced, and the water would be, they need the water in summer. So this is a really conflict there. You can't travel from one country to the other. On the other hand, you see examples where the water issues is not conflict, it's also kind of the ways how countries can really cooperate as well. So I wouldn't see this kind of transboundary issue just as a conflict area. It may also be a very big area where there could be a meeting place and it may serve for other kind of transboundary conflicts to solve as well.
Good. Well, this has really been exciting, and you've given us great insights into these global problems. I think for me, it's a desperate rush now to understand how these systems work, given the reduction in field-based studies, despite the number of dots in your biological observatories, and the race to understand these systems before they're all so engineered that we've lost hope of, you know, understanding free-flowing river processes. So it's been really both sobering look and a great overview. I'd like to thank you and have everyone join in thanking you for a great talk.
Thank you. Thank you.